We seem to have some users that, either by mistake or on purpose, are signing up with email addresses that don't exist or are not theirs. This issue is made worse by the fact that we've associated Google login emails with the email password logins that the user enters. This is starting to look like a major security issue. Here, let me show you. All right, so here's Walter. And here we have an evil hacker. Let's say that Walter logs in with Google, and that his Google account is associated with his Gmail account, which has the address AmericanGuyW1521@gmail.com. When this account is created, it also creates a user in our database. So he logs in, and he's all happy, and he makes some shopping lists. Okay, so the hacker figures out Walter's Gmail address because maybe Walter isn't too shy about sharing it. He puts it up on a social networking site or something like that. And then what the hacker does is he makes an account through email and password that uses the same email address. And with how we've set things up, he gets to choose whatever password he'd like, and it's fine for him to use this email. Because the real Walter never made a user in Firebase with email and password, just with Google. With the code as it is now, these two accounts here are associated, and they're considered to be the same user. So the hacker has now essentially gotten into Walter's account, because the same email address was used for both. And all those new permissions that we added, such as only the owner can change the name of a list, or only the owner can delete a list, are meaningless because, well, the hacker's gotten into Walter's account. So he can rename Walter's lists as much as he likes, and poor Walter is powerless to do anything about it. As we start writing more code related to ownership in the app, Walter's going to get the ability to make lists that are private to himself, but with this security flaw, a hacker would be able to see all of Walter's private items and lists. Now, you might be saying, let's unassociate the two email addresses, but this would still leave an issue that the hacker could enter this account and sort of masquerade as Walter. It would also mean that Walter could not use his own email address if he ever decided to make a email password provider user. So I think a better way to go about this is to try and think of a way that we can have the user prove that they actually own the email address that they've put in. To do this, you can employ a creative use of Firebase's password reset functionality. Here I am in the login and auth tab, and if you scroll down, you'll see this section that's all about password resets. In your code, you can trigger for a user to receive a password reset email. And here's where you can configure what that email will look like. You can configure things like what the subject of the email will be or who it's from. And if you scroll down a little bit more, here's the actual body of the email. Now this includes a token string, and this token string is basically the reset password that is generated for your user. So with all of this in mind, here's the new flow that I'm thinking of. First, when the user signs up, they'll no longer be asked for a password. Instead, the screen will just take their email and their name. This is the information that will be used in the call to create user. We'll generate a sort of dummy password that we're going to throw away pretty quickly. Because if creating that user is successful, we'll immediately reset the password using the reset password method. Immediately after resetting the password, an intent will open the user's default email app. Now, reset password is the method that triggers that email to be sent to the user, and it uses the email address that they entered here. So as long as they're connected to the internet, they should see that the first email in their email inbox is the password reset email. And they can go ahead and open that email and get a randomly generated password. They can then copy the password that's in their email and navigate back to the app. When they return to the app, instead of seeing the create account activity screen, instead they'll see the login activity screen. And we can even be nice and pre-populate the email up here with whatever email they originally gave us. Then if we instructed them to copy the password here, they can paste it here and sign in. And for now, the first time that the user signs in, we can actually use Firebase's change password method to then change the random password that was originally generated for the user to the reset password that they just put in. And in this way, we can confirm that the user at least has access to the email account that they put in here. Okay, now this is by no means perfect. For one, it makes the reset password the user's permanent password. And the reset password's fairly hard to remember. It's just some sort of random string of numbers and digits. Also, when you call the reset password method, whatever password is generated only works for 24 hours. So there is a scenario where a user could create a new user, get the reset email, and then get busy and decide not to sign in, and then try to sign in after 24 hours and lose access to their account. But for beta version 0.3, I think this is a pretty good flow, and it does remove the most glaring security flaws of our current login process. Okay, so let me quickly show you these two methods that are new to you. The reset code is pretty straightforward. Just like everything else that we've been doing with authentication, you should grab a Firebase ref. You can then call reset password on that Firebase ref. And all it really needs is an email address that's in the system, which means an email address that you've called create user with. If this reset password call is successful, it'll send an email and take you here. And if it's not successful, you'll get the error down here. This might happen, for example, if you put in an email address here that doesn't exist in the system. You'd get the user does not exist error that we've talked about before. When the user signs in for the first time, you should call it the change password method. This will take that same email address of the user, as well as the old password and the new password. You can use the reset password for both of these. Now, you should only change the password if this is the first time that the user's logging in. I'll leave it up to you to decide how to check whether the user has logged in before or hasn't logged in before. And if you forgot why calling change password is important, it's because the user's reset password that they received in their email is only valid for 24 hours. Now, if Shopping List Plus was going into production immediately, what I'd have you do is create some extra screens so that the user could change their password from the reset password to something that they can memorize a little bit easier. But again, we'll start with this. Okay, the full spec is on the way, so good luck.